Arch Linux can be a nightmare for inexperienced first-time users.
I'm not actually liking it at all, no.
It's so complicated. I actually can't believe that people would be using this. Do you want to know what I think of Arch Linux? My arch enemy.
But when you know how to use it, you can limitlessly create whatever computer setup you desire. Let's show Diana how to set up Arch Linux into something she could actually use this week on OS FirstTimer. Welcome to Mum Learns How to Use Arch Linux. Arch Linux has been installed to this 320 gig hard drive. In the original Mum Tries Out Arch Linux, she had no access to the Arch Linux wiki, which has so much good documentation on exactly how to use Arch Linux. This time around, I'm going to be guiding her and even referencing to the actual guide.
And so this time I'm going to give Arch Linux a fair go.
Okay, so first you need to log in. So you just type in your username. This is supposed to be easy.
I can't even get the name right.
Just don't worry, you will learn to use Arch Linux. You'll be a professional, almost said a professor, a professional Arch user. So when you first log in, it looks like this. So this is Arch Linux in its almost default state. I've followed the beginner's guide, and this tells you step by step how to install Arch Linux and everything. It may look like this installation is a long, complicated process, but it's actually giving you a lot of description on exactly how to do everything. And the commands that you're typing in to install are actually just very small, see? And it just says all the stuff you have to do and what the commands do and everything like that. The sound is actually working out of the box, but what I've done is I've unmuted the sound because by default sound is muted in Arch Linux. For the graphical user interface, I've installed the X window system. The X window system is basically what you need to actually have any window managers and desktop environments. Without it, it's very hard to have any like graphical stuff displayed on the screen. I've also installed a video driver which allows all the graphics output to be displayed to the screen rather than just, you know, console and text. I've also installed the Xorg TWM window manager and the clock and the terminal.
Why do they call it Pac-Man?
You'll find out in a second what this whole Pac-Man thing is about.
Okay.
The first thing you're going to do is install a text-based file manager, which is going to run just in the command line, so you won't be in a graphical environment straight away. Now, to install a program, you have to type in Pac-Man.
Okay, so Pac-Man?
Pac-Man stands for Package Manager.
Oh, okay.
Then, once you've typed in Pac-Man, put a space.
That'll
okay,
work.
This thing that looks like a dash on the keyboard, you press that. Then you do a capital S. And then you type the name of the program, so Pac-Man, and I think this is called an S-switch. And then the name of the program, which in this case is Ranger. So press enter. But...
Oh, unless you are root.
Basically that means to install software, you need to have administrative privileges.
Well, why didn't you give me administrative privileges if I'm supposed to be doing this Arch Linux thing?
You do have administrative privileges, but you've just got to enable them. To enable administrative privileges, just type in sudo su. So sudo and then su. Then you type in your password and then you can install stuff. So this time around when we go to install something, it looks it up, tells you how big the download size is. And it also, see how it says packages? It finds the dependencies as well.
I seem to need a Python and a Ranger.
You're downloading Ranger, the actual software that you wanted, but Ranger won't work unless you have Python. Because if you look at this, it was written in Python, which is a programming language type thing. So you actually need that programming language on the computer before you can even get Ranger. So it'll download both for you. So whenever you download something, you don't have to go, oh, what do I need for this? Oh, I need this programming language. I need this and this and this.
Right.
And all these compilers. It does it all for you. So it's very simple. You need Ranger, you type in Ranger, it'll get everything you need as well, but it'll just show you what's there. So do you want to download?
Yes.
Yes, so just type yes. Then it downloads it for you. And as you can see, it's all text-based, so it's first given Python, because you need Python before you can get the Ranger software. See how it's even got a progress bar, all text-based? Because you're still in the command line. There's no graphical environment yet. And there we go, it's installed. So now to open a program, you type in the name of the program. So if you want to open Ranger, type in Ranger. And here is Ranger.
It's apparently empty.
Yep, because you don't really have any files right now. But if I come out of the home folder, so you can use up and down to scroll up and down, see, and it shows you what's in folders. So if you didn't have this file viewer and all of this, you would have to manually go CD and then type in the folder. For example, if you wanted to access this folder dev, you'd have to type in CD dev. And then within the dev folder, you would then have to type in ls to list all of these folders. And if you want to enter another folder, you'd have to type in CD disk to enter that. And you get it's a big slow process. This way, you've just got the keyboard. You can use up and down to quickly view all the files on your computer. Mm. Do you think that's a good program?
Yeah, it is.
Now, I've just quit that program. But as you can see, when I quit the program, by the way, to quit it, I pressed Control Z. Once I quit the program, it still seems like the program's still running, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But what's happening is, look, see how it says it stopped Ranger, and then now you're continuing, you can start typing stuff. To clear the screen, you just type in clear, and then it clears the screen for you. Now, we're actually going to start doing graphical stuff.
Sure. Does that mean we're choosing the desktop background?
A lot more than just the desktop background. I'm talking a whole environment. You're going to be using window managers and desktop environments, but before we get to that, I'm just going to show you a very basic one.
Okay.
It's a window manager called TWM. To open it, you just have to type in StartX. Whenever you want to open the window manager that you've got on your computer, you just type in StartX as one word.
Well, apparently it wants to bash me up because that's not right.
Before you open the graphical interface, however, let me show you what happens if you try to open a graphical program. Type in xcalc to open the clock. And look what it says. It says can't open display because you're not in a desktop environment. So now type StartX.
One word or?
Yep, one word.
Whoa, okay.
Now, this is a very basic window manager.
It's got three windows open now.
Yep, and look at what you've got. You've got a mouse that you can move around. On the desktop, it appears as an X. You can even move these windows around like this.
Yeah.
As you can see, it's opened up three terminals. A terminal is basically that big command screen you saw before that you can access from a desktop or a window manager. I'm just going to exit them by typing in exit. To open stuff, here's a great example of how you would open stuff. The name of the program in this case is xcalc, so type in xcalc and it will open xcalc. And now you put the mouse where you want it. So where do you want the program to open?
In the corner there.
Okay.
Right click, left click.
Yep, and there's your clock. And because it's a window manager, you're able to have multiple windows, move them around the screen, even resize them. The resize button's actually here, so you pull that point and resize it like that. And you can make it as big as you want.
I'm not sight challenged. That's okay.
Okay, then.
We don't need it that big.
Okay, so can you just left click on the desktop now?
Well, I did.
Keep your finger on the desktop. Yep.
And kill.
And now click on the program you want to kill.
What's the difference between killing and deleting? Does delete mean it's still alive somewhere, but killing it, it's dead?
Just kill it. Don't kill the killer. You're going to kill the clock. Click on the clock, because that's what you want to kill.
Okay.
There we go. So as you can see, this doesn't have like an X kind of thing at the top. It's pretty annoying, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Now I'm going to get you to get a calculator, a graphical calculator called xcalc. Type in Pac-Man and then the xorg-xcalc. Okay, just press yes. Now type in xcalc, it's installed. And now where do you want to put the calculator? And there we go, it's an actual calculator, and you can click and you can calculate with it. Have a little go. Do like 8 plus 7, or times 7.
8 plus 7.
Equals, and there you go, 15.
Yeah.
So, do you find it pretty easy to get programs?
It is, actually, when you're telling me what to do.
To get a program, what do you do?
That Pac-Man, meaning package manager,
yep.
Space, dash, capital S.
Yep, and then the name of the program.
Yeah.
What is a program that you absolutely love?
Well, you've got to have Firefox.
Okay, well, can you get Firefox for me? I've just opened a new terminal because this one was linked to this calculator. So now we're getting Firefox. And look at how many dependencies Firefox has. So we're going to press yes to get all those dependencies. It requires a lot of stuff. And now it's going to install Firefox. Okay, now that Firefox is installed, can you please open Firefox?
Do I just type in Firefox?
Yep, you just type in Firefox, the name of the program.
And it failed?
No, it opened. And here you go, here is Firefox.
Well, what's so embarrassing? What's this serial killer Dexter and boy genius Dexter?
Oh, no, that was me testing. I was looking at a random video on YouTube.
And that's the type of thing you look at?
No, it was the first thing that appeared when I went onto YouTube, www.google.com.au. But anyway, as you can see, this is Firefox. Can you tell that this is Firefox?
Definitely.
And it's running.
Wow.
Does it make you feel like, wow, I've got something working on Arch Linux?
It's Firefox.
And it works perfectly. Like, if you go through everything, for example, go onto YouTube using this. One thing you may notice, though, look at the fonts. Do you notice it looks a little bit different?
It does, actually.
The text.
It's fancy.
The reason is because it doesn't actually have the real text installed, so you would actually have to download the real font that Firefox requires.
I don't mind this font. It looks fancy.
Okay, then we'll get into YouTube and just click on a random video. Just that.
That YouTube or that?
Yeah, that YouTube. And now just find a random video.
Where's the search? Do I cross that out?
Cross that out. And notice how it doesn't have an X.
Oh, that one.
Okay. Flash player is required.
So now we have to get flash player.
Well, I've watched some videos and some of them really, they don't require flash player. Like if we click on... Oh, here we go. See? That one doesn't. And as you can see, it's got sound and everything. Okay, there we go. Sorted. So as you can see, you can get Flash Player to get more videos working, but that's it. You've got Firefox perfectly running on your computer, but you're not quite happy with the way. Do you really want to be typing in Firefox to open Firefox?
I want a little icon.
Yeah, you want icons. You want an actual desktop environment.
And I would like to install that proper video thing so I can
Flash.
See. Oh, yes.
Yeah, you could do that. Just let me show you something, though. You can move the windows around, but dragging is annoying because you can't, like, drag from the corners, can you? You've got to use this thing at the top to drag, and that gets a bit annoying, and then there's no X button. Like, when you press this,
can we create
it becomes
an X
a silly-looking Firefox thing. This is just the way this window manager works. I'm going to get you to download a new window manager now. This is from the Arch Linux Wiki, and this is its article on a window manager. It says, window managers are X clients that provide border around a window. The window manager controls the appearance of an application and how it's managed. The border, the title bar, the size, ability to resize the window is all handled by the window manager. Window managers generally don't provide extras like desktop icons, which are commonly seen in desktop environments. So a window manager is like a really basic kind of little environment for you, and a desktop environment it is a fully fledged stuff with heaps more like applications and stuff. Here's a list of some window managers. Now there's two types of window managers. There's a stacking. Stacking window managers provide the traditional desktop metaphor, so that basically means windows act like pieces of paper on a desk and they can be stacked on top of each other. So you know, with like Windows XP, you can like move windows on top of each other, stuff like that. There's also tiling window managers, which have no windows overlapping.
No,
means so it'll tile it like one here, one here, one here.
I want the stacking.
And you can't move them around. So you want a stacking one. Now here is a list of some stacking ones. Look at them all. All different kinds of window managers that
are
stacking.
I just randomly pick one, or will you tell me what you?
I was gonna tell you one that I think's just a nice example of one. Black box.
I like Enlightenment.
When you tried out Bodhi Linux, you tried out Enlightenment. So I'm just giving you something else, which is very simple and, it's Black Box.
Isn't that a music group?
Anyway, it says what it is. It says Black Box is a fast, light window manager without annoying dependencies. And to get it, it shows you how to get it. See this? Black Box, you just have to type in Black Box.
Okay, where do I type Black Box?
In a terminal. So just open a terminal up, enter, and then yes, Y, and enter. It's done. So to open Black Box, I've just typed in Black Box. And as you can see, Black Box now has its proper, X.
Yeah, it has a maximize. Proper closing. Yeah.
So it is a bit better and you can drag the windows and even resizing. I like the way you resize in Black Box. You just go like this. It's also got, if you right click on the desktop, if you wanted to open the calc, I can just click calc. And there we go. Everything looks a lot better in Black Box, doesn't it?
It certainly does.
And you can also come over here, choose a style. So what colour do you want for the background?
I wouldn't mind just purple, actually.
Purple? And then you've got a purple background.
Yeah.
So do you like how that works?
And I do.
It tells you what program is open at the bottom. In fact, I'm just going to change this to green because I can't see a thing. You can even go multiple workspaces. See, two? So it's like multiple desktops.
How many multiple desktops are there?
Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 by default. And then if you, at this point, open Firefox, there's Firefox.
Why is it always embarrassed when you open it?
Maybe it's because I'm not closing it properly. This time around, you've even got your X and the little, minimise thing.
Yeah.
Do you find this a much better environment than the last?
Oh, definitely, yes.
Now I'm going to give you a fully fledged desktop environment. A desktop environment bundles together a variety of X clients and common graphical user interface elements such as icons, windows, toolbars, wallpapers, desktop widgets, and, you know, stuff that you usually see. We're gonna, and here's some officially supported ones, so there's Cinnamon, Enlightenment, GNOME, KDE, LXDE, XFace, and then some less supported ones. But we're going to be trying out KDE.
Why did you specifically choose that one?
Just because I like how customizable KDE is.
Okay.
And I'm a bit more familiar with it myself.
Right.
So instead of doing a full install of KDE, which absolutely gets all these extra programs and stuff, we're just going to do the minimal install of KDE. And to do that, you just install KDE Base. So here's KDE Base, and I'll just show you what it includes. When you install KDE Base, you get a full set of wallpapers, a file manager, ability to change your password, and see all these little things, a terminal, a text editor, file browser, and, you know, web browser, and all of that. Let's get KDE. We're going to open the terminal, and I want you to now type in the Pac-Man thing and get KDE Base.
Is it KDE?
Yep, Base. Now just press enter to get all of these. We're just doing all the defaults, and yes. And now it's downloading it. So what are you thinking of Arch Linux so far, the way that you can just download programs? For example, to download Firefox, what you would normally have to do is, okay, I'm going to go to the Firefox website. So I've got to open a browser, I've got to go to the Firefox website, either Google search Firefox or type, you know, Firefox.com or whatever it is, Mozilla/Firefox, whatever.
Yeah.
Download it, then once it's downloaded, I've got to find the installer, then install it, next install.
It's much easier to download.
In Arch Linux, it downloads and installs simply by typing Pacman-S Firefox, and you've got Firefox downloaded and installed.
That's really good, but why doesn't Windows do that then?
There
is an ability to do it. I mean, Arch Linux is demonstrating it's able to be done.
Windows doesn't use the same Arch Linux package manager. You could open a terminal or what's called the command prompt in Windows, but if you typed in Pac-Man and all that S stuff, it would not actually download Firefox. This is just the way Arch Linux works. It's package manager where you can just type that in and it'll just grab it for you. And you can do that for a number of programs. You could type in, like, for example, if you wanted to edit audio and stuff, you'd just type in Pacman-S audio.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to remove a program, you type in Pacman-RS Firefox. I'm saying RS because if you type in RS, it'll remove the program and all its dependencies. You know how sometimes, like, Firefox didn't just get Firefox, it had to get all this other stuff that Firefox depended to run. That removes the dependencies as well.
Okay.
So that's why I'm saying RS. So now that the base of KDE is installed without all, like, the extra applications and stuff it comes with, simply start it by typing KDM.
So you type KDM to get KDE to start?
Yes, but it specifically states in the actual wiki for the KDM. So as you can see, this is a full now desktop environment that's now loading up. So now, as you can see, this is kind of a full desktop environment that's loading up. Just type your password in. See how it's even got a login box and stuff. Does it look nice?
It does.
So it's just loading up now. Now, the thing is, I had to uninstall the TWM, that you remember that one you didn't like?
Yeah.
Just so it wouldn't conflict with this.
Right, okay. Why didn't we just load this one up to begin with?
Because I needed to show you some basics of, like, what a window manager is versus this, which, as you can see, is a desktop environment. It's got the time in a little bar at the bottom. As you can see, you've got this start menu, right? And you've got, like, applications and system and settings and stuff, but this is a bit annoying like this. You can actually right-click it and click switch to classic menu, and what do you notice? This is just the way you like it.
Oh, it is, actually.
See? So if you want, for example, what have you gotten? Remember you got the Firefox browser?
Yeah,
there it is,
Firefox.
See?
Yeah.
So if you got anything else, it would appear automatically categorized in here. That's pretty awesome, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
If you want to change the desktop background, you can go ahead and change the desktop background. So I'm just going in the settings. What do you think about these windows here that come with KDE? See how it's got these, like, an X and a minimized,
and
a glow effect. Notice
a glow.
The glow.
I was about to say it's
glow.
Yeah,
blue glow. You can change all that.
Don't change it. I should
like
it.
So
I want that one.
You want this image. Okay, apply. There we go. And it's still glowing. You could probably even change the glow as well. And
I don't want to change the glow. I actually really like it the way it is.
The blue glow.
Yeah.
Okay, fantastic.
It's really modern.
You can also change stuff, because this is highly customizable. For example, add panel, I could add an empty panel, see, and it's added one to the top. And you could add whatever you wanted up there. For example, on this panel, let's say you wanted to add a widget. You'd call this a taskbar, wouldn't you?
Yes, I would.
This is actually a panel, and it's got widgets on it. For example, it's got the time widget, which tells you the time. And that widget has just been placed there.
What's a scissors widget? What does that do?
Oh, it's just a clipboard tool. So it's stuff like when you copy and paste stuff, it can appear there.
And then the thing next to it looks like a USB sign.
Yep, it's just showing you the available drive. So I've got a disk in there, and yep, the 320 gig drive is also seen here. Let's add some widgets to this. If I click add widgets, and see all these different widgets you can see. Application launcher, see this? An application launcher is just this thing, which brings up like a start menu. Okay, so if you wanted one of those, you could have one of those.
But I've already got one of those there.
Yeah, so you wouldn't really need one.
No.
Now, you could add any of these widgets. You could add them to this bar.
I think
you
a battery monitor would be handy, you know, for a laptop.
Yeah, for a laptop, yeah. So let's use this top bar as a quick launch area. So I'm just going to put quick launch on the top bar. See how it's put these two little objects here to quick launch? You could add stuff to that quick launch bar. So I can drag Firefox right from here and put it into the quick launch bar. So all these applications, you can put a bunch of applications at the top of the screen,
so
as an example.
So the things that would you would use most often,
yeah,
you can just put up there,
yeah,
and they become
launch.
Like icons.
Yeah.
Instead of having icons here on the desktop to mess up.
But that's the thing. You can have icons on the desktop.
I like this.
You can have them up on a top bar. You can even remove the top bar and you could put them there.
I wouldn't even have that application thing because it involves multiple steps to go in and get it. I would just put all the things I use across the top.
As small things at the top. Oh, okay. So that's how you'll do it?
Yes.
Okay.
And then can we do away with that thing then? So have it just totally customised to how I want it?
Oh, yeah. You could do that if you wanted. Another thing you can do is you can change the height. So if you wanted this to be a bit bigger and display everything.
No, my site is bigger.
Okay, so how big do you want it?
That'll do.
Like that size?
Yeah.
Okay. You can also change, for example, the screen edge. So you can have it a bit lower.
No.
Or you
like
it at
the
top.
Yeah. I actually think that's
okay. And you can even move it so it's like in the middle. Or
No. I want it starting from there and going
all
to
the way.
The end.
Okay, then.
With all the applications
that
I use.
You usually use. Okay. I can move it all the way to the edge. When you open stuff, notice what happens. So if I open Firefox, which I could have just clicked up there, you'll notice that it actually appears in here at that bottom bar. So
this shows what you have open from up here.
Well, technically, this shows you anything you've got open, and you can minimise and maximise to there. You could actually merge that so that appears in the top here, like on maybe everything you've got open there. If you wanted, for example, you could get this application launcher and just remove this application launcher menu and remove this. And remove this launcher, and remove this.
Yeah, that's how I want it.
At the bottom,
This is exactly the way I would want it. I want to know what I have open at the bottom, and every single thing I use at the top as a little, like, an icon thing. I can just see it and click on it. I don't want to have, a menu thing, because that's multiple steps to get into. That's the way I would do it. Continue on. So I'll tell you what I want on there. I want the office. I want a spreadsheet-type application.
So, for example, let's get LibreOffice. So you would need to open the terminal. In fact, do you know what would be a good idea?
What?
Right now, if I want to add all these widgets and stuff, it's a good idea if I kind of just have this here. Oops. Where did it go? Okay, well, I've put it on the desktop just quickly. You can add all the widgets to the desktop as well if you want. They don't have to be on a bar.
I like them on a bar.
And see, there it is there. But you do like them on a bar.
Yeah,
so,
I do.
Yeah, you can drag it and move it onto a bar. So if you wanted, you could have their little menu launcher there. Something that you are going to use quite often is the terminals. So I'll add Xterm up to here as well. And this is where you're going to get all your little applications. So there we go, Xterm. And you can type in stuff, Pac-Man and all of that, and then that'll install it up to the top here. Would you prefer this, instead of being there, would you prefer it to be in the absolute corner?
I think it needs to be in the corner.
Yeah, because otherwise it's kind of, yeah.
But we can get rid of it once we've gotten all our little
things you can.
On the top.
And then if you need to add things, you can always click add widgets and then you can add it back again. Also, just a feature of KDE, when you put your cursor up here by default, it'll show you all the windows you have open. Like that. Okay, so let's say, what's something else? LibreOffice?
Yes.
Okay, so type in LibreOffice. Oh, well, Pac-Man. The good thing is that you can Google exactly what you need to type in on the Arch Wiki, and let's say you want LibreOffice, you can just see, okay, how do I install it? You just type in LibreOffice to install LibreOffice, see? And it'll get the whole office. So by typing in that, that will get you 12 things. Now, look at what it does. You can actually get everything in there or just one thing. For example, if you just want the drawer, or you just want the calc, or you just want the math application or Impress. Impress is the actual, like, PowerPoint. Or if you want Writer, you can just type in something. So, for example...
Okay, well, I would want the Writer, just a normal...
Do you want everything or just...
No, I don't want everything, because I'm not going to use
everything. Okay, so you type in 12.
And I want the calculator, because calculator's a useful thing.
And it needs
thing.
All this stuff. Oh, it's not actually a calculator, it's a spreadsheet.
Oh, like an Excel spreadsheet.
Yeah, like
Well,
Excel.
I would like that too.
Okay, then.
But I don't
we'll just
like
get
it,
this first.
I don't like it being called calculator. I want to change its name to spreadsheet.
And you can change its name, but it would just be an icon. You wouldn't even see its name. Unless you want its names to be displayed, then you could change
it. As long as it doesn't look like a calculator.
Yeah, it wouldn't look like a calculator. We'll see what the Writer looks like. This desktop environment is called KDE. Are you happy about the way it looks and the way you can change things, put a bar up there that does stuff and add widgets to it and...
I love the
you
fact
can customize.
That I can totally customize it any way I want. And this way that I'm actually customizing it, I'm not customizing it to look like what I'm currently using.
Yeah.
I'm actually customizing it to look like something I would like it to look like.
Yeah.
Because obviously with the other operating systems, you really don't have much of a choice. You're limited.
Well, actually, some operating systems do come with KDE.
And but Windows, for instance, you're pretty limited with how it looks.
You are pretty limited, but you can...
You can change the odd thing, but I mean, with this, it's totally customizable.
You could even change the theme. You
well,
can
what
change
makes
the way
this...
that these
Okay,
look.
If you're saying that everything is totally customizable, what makes this more special than anything else?
What?
This Arch Linux.
People like Arch Linux because it gives them the opportunity to spread out anywhere they want.
Certainly does.
Okay, let me try and explain that again. People like Arch Linux because it gives you a base of practically nothing to start off with. Then you can choose, okay, what do I want? I want KDE. I want then these programs. A normal Linux distro such as Ubuntu would come with a bunch of other programs. So it would come with LibreOffice, but it might come with Cheese and other stuff that you don't want.
Right, yeah.
So this way, if you start off with the base of Arch Linux, you can just type in Pac-Man and get what you want. You wanted KDE, you just type Pac-Man KDE base or the full KDE if you want.
But I like the fact that I can make this look exactly the way I want. Like instead of having like a big menu thing like you have with Windows, for instance, I just want at the top to have all my little things that I always use. I don't want to even have icons on the screen like the traditional Windows has icons. And I don't want to even have like a Mac dock that shows all these things. I just want this.
So you prefer this little bar that you've like come up with?
Yeah, I do.
Rather than a dock.
Yeah, and rather than a menu that, because a menu means multiple steps.
Yeah.
Whereas this, you just look at the one you want,
click
on it.
Click it, and then all the ones that you've got open are all at the bottom.
Yeah, I know, and
okay,
it shows
so
you what you've got open at the bottom.
Okay, just to show you, LibreOffice is finished now. It's in Office, there it is, LibreOffice Writer, and I'll just drag it up to the top, there it is. And if you open it up,
and
then you've got LibreOffice Writer.
Would it be considered minimalistic if you've only got up there stuff
yes.
that you're using,
and
which
the computer's
means that
faster,
it's fast?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not bad, actually. Windows isn't customizable like this. Like, you couldn't just have a top bar and...
You can't go into Windows and say, okay, I want Windows and I don't want it to come with anything, and then I'm just going to start installing, okay, I want the Luna desktop environment. Which is not that Luna's
Mac,
a desktop environment. It's
you can't
XP
really
theme,
do this with Mac either, can you?
Typically, when you've got these desktop environments that are open source, it's a lot more customizable than one that isn't open source. Of course, you could try and do third-party programs and stuff with Windows that could make it a little bit more customizable or even fully customizable and look totally different. But with this Linux and the way these desktop
this
environments are
Linux,
set, these
Arch
are Arch, these are customizable out of the box.
Designed to make it look and act exactly the way you want it, right?
Yes, but just remember that KDE isn't, like, made for Arch Linux. KDE actually started before Arch Linux was made. KDE, I think, was the late 90s or something. So this KDE thing, you could have this pretty much on any Linux distro.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now we've got the spreadsheet software. Put it up next to the word. See that?
Yep.
That's all up.
I like that icon because I can tell exactly what it is.
Now, how do you know that that's a spreadsheet program?
Because it's got boxes in it and it's green. And in the Microsoft Excel spreadsheet, it's green.
It's green. So they're kind of copying that.
Yeah. Well, it makes me... It's familiar. It's
okay.
Familiar. Now I want a real calculator there. The only thing I don't like about the Linux is that they call that a calculator. I don't
like that.
That
the
call it a spreadsheet. It's a spreadsheet. And call a calculator.
Well, actually, if you put your cursor over it, look at this. It tells you exactly what it is. Well, LibreOffice Calc spreadsheet.
I know.
LibreOffice Word Processor.
But don't call it a calculator. Call it a spreadsheet.
But notice what it does. For example, the file manager is called Dolphin.
I don't need that file manager. You can delete that.
But you need a file manager so you can look at all your files on your computer. See?
Can't
this
I
is
just...
a file manager. See? Images, documents and all that. Don't you want something that can show you your documents and...
But what if I just go into Writer? Doesn't it have all my documents saved there?
Yeah, but what if you're accessing like a USB or you're transferring stuff from the image folder to somewhere else or doing something like that?
I don't do things like that, so I'd get rid of it. I would just have my writing stuff,
really?
My spreadsheet stuff. Yeah, get rid of it.
Okay.
This
so
is my operating system. Get rid of the things I
And you don't use Conqueror, do you?
I don't even know what Conqueror is.
It's a web browser and file browser.
Why would I need that when I've got Firefox?
Okay. What's this? It just appeared there. Oh, quick launch. Okay.
Get rid of it.
Yeah, well... So there we go, you've got that, and that.
Okay, next up, a proper calculator.
The best way to find something on Arch Linux is if you Google search Arch Linux calculator, the list of application science, so calculator, and then these are a bunch of calculators. We might get xcalc. Do you want that one? See,
yep.
There's lots of different calculators, but we'll get xcalc. Okay, so if you want xcalc, you just type in xcalc. If you press up, it gets you the last thing you typed. So now I can just type xcalc. So instead of typing all that Pac-Man stuff again, target not found. Oh, it must be called something else. Kcalc. Oh, that's what you actually have to type in to get it. KDE utils Kcalc. Okay. See, do you like how it always tells you what you need to type to install it, though?
Yes, but I like the fact that I can get all this created at the top, then never have to deal with
this again. Yeah, this again. And then, yes. So, are you serious that you wouldn't want this?
Yeah, I'm positive. I don't want that because that's multiple steps to get into your thing. This is just instant, and I like instant.
Well, here's kcalc.
Yep, pop it up there. Fantastic.
There it
and you
is.
Know
so
what?
There's
it
the
even looks like a proper calculator. That's great.
Do you like how it goes transparent even a little bit when you move it around the screen?
Not really, because it makes it hard then to see what you're calculating.
While you're calculating, it wouldn't do that, see?
Yeah. But why?
The only reason is while you're moving, if you can see, I wonder what's behind that, you see? That's why you'd have that feature.
Next up.
Is there anything else you need?
I'm trying to think.
An internet, a terminal.
What's a terminal? I don't even need a terminal.
The terminal is this thing, so you can actually install new stuff, so you can type in stuff.
Oh, so that allows you then to install.
Yeah, install stuff.
Okay, well, I would actually put that at the beginning.
Oh, so you would actually move the location of that.
Yep.
Oh, okay. Now, for example, you don't like how it's called LibreOffice Calc, do you? So if I right-click on that and click icon settings, instead of calling it calc.
Leave the LibreOffice and just delete.
LibreOffice. Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
Updating. And now it's just called LibreOffice spreadsheet.
That's exactly what it is.
And you could do that with that as well if you wanted that to say word processor.
Writer is pretty logical.
Instead of kcalc, because you don't like the name, you can obviously change the name to just calc.
Calc. Yes.
So you could set up perfectly the way you wanted it exactly.
I like that, actually.
Altering the names of everything. Mm. So is this kind of your perfect environment?
Yes,
you like KDE
completely.
And you like how
I
it works.
It.
You could install CompWiz and make it all wobbly Windows and do all that if you really wanted all of that.
That's okay.
I know. But that's the way it works. And if you don't like this desktop environment, you can have other ones, ones that look
there
completely different.
There is something else I would put on there, on-off switch. To shut down the computer.
Oh, okay, sure.
That's another
very...
thing, but I would have that in that corner.
In that corner. So what you can do is you go to Add Widgets, because this is actually a widget now, and look for a Turn Off button.
Yep,
there it
one.
Is. See, log or log off?
Yeah, put it right in the corner.
So there?
Yep.
The thing is, you've got to add a separate setting, so if you don't want leave, you can just have lock. Well, that's lock. Oh, no, leave. No, it's actually leave. That's what you want.
Yeah.
Okay, so leave. You would have to add like a little separator in between here. Oh, there we go. It's called a spacer. See this? Mm-hmm. So I'll just add the spacer. There we go. And I'll put that on this side of the spacer. And there
Perfect.
We go.
Perfect.
So you've got everything the way you like it. Now, one thing that's really important, if you turn the computer off and turn it back on, you're going to be thrown back into that text command line.
How do we keep it in?
And then to get back into this, you'd type in KDM, and it would get you into this. But there's a way to do it. There's a special startup file. I think it's .xinitrc, and if you edit that and put, like, KDE to start up, it even tells you how to do it. If you read the Arch Linux wiki, it'll tell you how to do that. We won't go into that now, but if you did want to do that, you just type that in, and every time you turn the computer on, it would come straight to this,
rather than
going through the text interface and command stuff first.
Good.
Is this perfectly the way you'd have your computer?
Yes. Absolutely perfect. This is the Diana desktop. I am 100% happy with this.
Yeah.
It beats every single operating system that I have ever tried and probably will ever try, because it just has the things that I use there.
Yeah.
And I can, with your help, use that to add more things as I need them.
Yeah.
I know exactly where to turn off the computer there. I know exactly what I've got open down here, and I even know what time it is. And this is totally uncluttered, and it's minimalistic, meaning that I only have on it what I need, and as I need new things, I can add new things, which means technically it should run very quickly. So for me, this is the Diana desktop. Perfect. Created by Arch Linux. And you know what the best thing about it is?
Yeah.
Even though I'm so familiar with the Windows menu and going through menus, why do you need a menu when you can just go straight into what you need? Go straight to turn off the computer. Why do you even need a menu? This is perfect.
You're fine with the fact that there's two almost like taskbars, one at the top and one at the bottom.
Yes, because this is the one with all the little pictures of the things that I just have to look at it. I know instantly what it is.
Yep.
I can use it.
And even name them yourself.
And this one, yeah, that's good too. And this down the bottom tells me which ones I have open. So, I mean, even if, no, I'm not going to say that. I was going to say even someone stupid could use this. This is, for me, the perfect operating system.
Careful the way you're saying that. The perfect operating system, remember, is the way you install stuff on Arch, the way you really like to install stuff. Do you prefer installing stuff on Windows? Would you prefer to go to the Firefox website and install it that way?
Well, let's just say...
Or do you think Pac-Man-Firefox is easier? What's easier to do?
Let's just say that I have got a son that can help me install the things that I want. And once those things that I want are installed, they're there for good.
This is KDE. Okay, you're putting a lot of emphasis on this being like the best operating system.
It is.
But what you're looking at right now, this whole interface and stuff, this is a desktop environment that's allowing you to customize and do all that. This desktop environment is KDE. So you could actually set up another Linux distribution to look like this if you wanted to. As long as you install KDE and set it up just the way you just did, you could do the same. So do you think... Because you're talking about this so much, do you think KDE is a good desktop environment?
It's that the allows best. You to... It is the best desktop environment, and for me, that's quite exciting to get something that's absolutely perfect. For me, this is, for me, the perfect operating system. Totally easy to use, minimalistic, quick. Instead of going through menus and drop down this, drop down that, just select what you want.
Okay.
You know it's open, you know how to turn it off.
Okay, fantastic. And a great way to update this, there's a single command you type in, it'll update every single program on the entire computer all at once, just if you type in the one command. For example, let's say there was a new version of LibreOffice and Writer and all of that, and new Firefox versions, you just type in, for example, there's a little command and update, and then it's done.
So you're saying to me, like when I'm on my Windows one...
Yep.
And it says, before when you go to turn off the computer, sometimes
you want to
it'll
do updates.
Say installing,
yeah.
And then you have to wait till it
you installs install
all this
when you
stuff.
Want to. You just type in install and then it'll update.
And is it instant?
It does it as fast as it can download and install.
I think that's pretty good too.
So as you can see, Pac-Man can update all packages on your system in just one command. You just type in Pac-Man, then the little dash, S-Y-U, and that just updates everything.
I think that's fantastic.
All at once. So instead of, for example, you open Firefox, and then Firefox says, oh, there's an update available. And then suddenly Windows says, oh, there's an update available. Oh, and then you open Microsoft, there's an update.
I don't remember my computer going, oh, there's an update available.
Well, it's saying, you know, there's an update. And then you've got to do stuff like, please restart your computer to finish installing an update.
This is a fantastic idea.
Yeah, so all you do is you want to update everything at once. You just go to the terminal, type in Pac-Man, S-Y-U, and boom, everything's
updated. But you have to remind yourself to do that every so often. Okay, well, the only other things I would do is get rid of that.
So can you do that right now? Right-click them?
So once I've installed everything, and at the moment all I can think of needing is the Firefox, the writing thing, the spreadsheet and the calculator.
Yeah.
So right-click the ones you don't want. Two. Yep. So I'll right-click that.
And then remove this icon.
Yep. And then that.
Yep. And remove this application menu launcher.
So that's all I need there. Remove the pair of scissors because I don't even know what's that.
So right-click. And then remove the system tray. Yep. Done.
Oh, good.
So then you've just got the time, all your applications.
Oh, and by the way, I don't need to know that that's a desktop because I'm not that thick. I know it's a desktop. Can we remove that?
It's a toolbox. It's not just like, for example, you click on it and it says on the desktop you can add widgets and stuff. For example, if I wanted to add an analog clock.
That looks completely silly. Get rid of it.
So it looks silly.
You are polluting my desktop. Get rid of it.
As you can see, for the person who says they wish they had an operating system that comes with everything, they actually would prefer an operating system that comes with just what they need.
Just what I need.
Just minimalistic.
Yes. Just what I need. And can we get rid of that too?
Yeah.
Oh, look. Actually,
no, there we go. I put it in there.
So it's in there
now. Yeah, it's in there now.
Okay. Well, that's okay. So it's there in case in future I decide I do need a few extra things.
Do stuff,
okay,
yeah.
Well, for
so
me,
there we go.
That's all I need. This is probably going to be the easiest operating system to use, the quickest. I like it.
So just open a few things. Just open, for example, Firefox. Just try it out. There's Firefox, make it full screen for yourself. You can drag it or you could have just clicked the maximize button.
That's okay.
And then open a Word and the calculator. Just click on all of them actually. You don't even have to open or anything. Click on them all. And then that one.
There again, it's showing me all the things I have open.
That you need at the bottom. And I'll just zoom in and show you.
Could I just ask you why I have the little jumping thing there?
Oh, that's just telling you that it was opening Excel. If you wanted to see everything at once on the screen, you put your cursor up and there everything is. And then you can click on the one you want.
Yeah.
If you wanted, not saying that you'll do this, you could have it so you don't even have a taskbar at the bottom, and you go, oh, I'm going to switch my application now, click up here, and then choose, okay, that.
No, I like having that.
So you like that. You don't like this kind of switching between like
this. No. I like to have a top bar.
Yep. And a bottom bar.
Select what I want, and in that corner is the on-off.
Yep.
A bottom bar which tells me exactly what I've got open, and a clock. Perfect. This is the Diana Perfect Operating System.
The Diana Perfect Operating System. It's got a name, does it?
Certainly does now.
Can you now turn off your perfect operating system?
Of course I can, because I designed it.
Remember, it's not an operating system, though. It's just your customised setup of Arch Linux.
Well, for me, that's an operating system.
Okay.
And it's perfect. Here we go. You just can't get more perfect than this. This is perfect. They should sell this in a shop.
They should sell this.
Honestly, this is just absolutely...
Well, do you know what? If you wanted to, you could open your own computer business, make your own Linux distribution based on this Arch Linux with the way you've set that up, and you could sell the computers that come with this, and you could say, okay, this is Dinix, or whatever you want to call it. You'd name it. What would you name this?
The Diana Perfect Operating System.
The Diana...
And you know, I just cannot understand why anybody else would not consider this perfect. I mean, you've got all the things you use, and obviously for somebody else who's more computer savvy and they use a lot more things, fine, that could be filled up totally.
Yeah.
You've got an on-off thing. You don't have a menu that you're constantly flicking through to find things because it's right there with a picture showing exactly what it is. And down here, you know exactly what's open. You know what time it is. This is totally uncluttered, and I actually like that picture.
And you could even download, for example, remember that thing that kept on changing the desktop backgrounds? You could download that for this if you wanted.
What I can't understand is why you would use any other operating system.
When you start off with Linux, people think, oh no, I don't want to set this up all myself. I just want something that I can use.
Okay.
And they use Ubuntu.
I couldn't have set this up without you.
Yeah.
But let's just say once it is set up and you've got it totally the way you want it.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
I cannot believe how anybody would have any other operating system.
But one that's perfectly made for them.
But this is perfectly made for anyone.
No, but the thing is, people have different preferences.
You just add more things here that you use. But, I mean, do people actually like flicking through menus and having complicated things? And
what if you've got 100 programs installed? 100 programs will not fit in that.
You just make it a bit smaller. Or actually have two lines then.
You could have two rows, or you could have 50 rows, or whatever
just,
you want.
Just have how many rows you need to fit all the things you need.
But
this is perfect.
What if you wanted it all categorised?
What do you mean?
For example, okay, all my office applications in...
Office applications in that bar. This one here, that one there. You could do it. This is perfect. I keep saying it.
Okay. Well, can you turn off your perfect operating system now?
Yes, I can, because I know exactly where it is. I could do it blindfolded. There we go.
Do you think, actually, just a question, how fast do you think you could do the five tasks in this? Which would be, okay, so you would have to do the text document.
Okay, let's cancel this. See, I like this too.
No, but don't actually do it. Just show me what you do. Okay, so the first task, what time is it?
Okay,
you look
there.
At the bottom. Then the next task, LibreOffice, you know how to use it, you'd open it. Then the next task is calculate something.
There it is.
The next task is change the desktop background.
No, I would say I don't want to change the desktop background. It's perfect.
Okay, so but what you would do is you would right click, go to default desktop settings and choose the desktop background.
Oh, okay, well there you go. It's not that
difficult. And then to turn off, turn it off.
So, I mean, what can I say? The Diana Perfect operating system. Created from Arch Linux.
Based
KD,
on Arch Linux.
And KD, whatever it is.
KDE.
Perfect.
Okay.
The best.
Turn it off.
I can honestly, normally I don't like saying, oh, it's the best one, because I can never remember the previous ones I've tried. But this one, I can honestly say I will not find another operating system that will be more perfect than this. And
but remember, everything isn't, like, all the behind-the-scenes stuff, such as printer drivers. You'd have to install a printer driver compatible with your printer, and it doesn't do everything for you. You still have to get those other things that you're going to use it for, so...
You would help me do that, and once it's all set up, it's all perfect then.
What if I wasn't here? Would you be using this if I wasn't here?
I would have to hire somebody to come.
So you would actually think that the best way to set up computers is everyone in the world should be using Arch Linux, get someone to set it up just the way they like it, and that would be the perfect world of computers.
Yeah, it would be actually, yeah.
Okay, that's interesting you say that. Now turn off the computer and you know how to use Arch Linux.
It's fantastic.
Turn off the computer, restart or log off.
No, I'm going to turn it off.
Turn it off. Okay, see you next time.
Okay, see you next time. But I don't see the use. I found the perfect one.
Okay, well, maybe this is the end of OS First Time. We'll not see you next time. Channel's over. I'm joking. It's going to continue. You found the perfect one. Let's see if we can find the most unperfect operating system.
Okay, fine.
In fact, what's funny is the perfect one was originally the worst operating system, so the worst has just turned into the best. Anyway, it's crazy on OS First Time. So now the way that I've installed Arch Linux is because it is on this little portable hard drive there, I can plug it into any computer and it'll have that Arch Linux set up. So literally you could go around to all your friends' houses saying, hey, look at my computer, and you plug it into whatever computer you want, and it's basically your computer. It's like a laptop computer that you can plug in anywhere kind of thing.
That's pretty good.
So that's the way it's set up right now. The only disadvantage of that is it's a bit slower when it runs off a portable hard drive. And the other thing is you've got to remember drivers. I installed the NVIDIA driver for my computer so it would be able to display graphics, but when it's plugged into your computer, here we go, here's the exact Arch Linux, all the stuff is still there, but you don't have NVIDIA, I think you've got an Intel one or something, so I would have to go on the Arch Linux wiki, find out how to install the video driver for Intel, and then as soon as you've done that, it would actually boot the KDE on that.
Well, I must admit, my first experience of Arch Linux wasn't so good because I wasn't exactly shown how to get my perfect operating system, but as far as I'm concerned, Arch Linux is the best. You just need somebody to set it up for you the way you want it set up, telling them you want this there, that there. Then once that person sets it up, hey, look, you've got the best operating system ever.
Out of everything you've tried, Windows, Mac, and Linux distros from every single year, Windows 7, Windows XP, everything, you're telling me that your favourite operating system is Arch Linux, once it's customised the way you like it.
Is the Diana Perfect Arch Linux operating system? Yes, it is the best.
The Diana Perfect. Remembering that if you needed to access applications that are available for, like, Windows and stuff, you could install...
I just ask you to do it.
Well, you could install Wine, so you could run all the stuff that you need, or if you wanted to be extra precise, you could even install Windows XP or Windows 7 in a virtual machine, so you've got all your Arch Linux happening here, and then in another window, you've got XP running or whatever operating system you want, which is compatible with everything XP is. And you could have
even XP, Windows 7 and Vista installed on the same little virtual machine thing, if you wanted.
No, I would just want the Arch Linux, but just get the little things on it that
so
make
Wine.
It compatible with
everything. With Windows. Yeah. So you wouldn't want, like, a virtual machine inside of it?
No.
You just
too
want everything? Oh, okay.
I just want my perfect operating system, the exact way that I created it, and whatever you need to do to make it compatible with things, and I leave that up to you.
So that's drivers and stuff.
Yeah.
Video drivers for getting it to display on other computers. Wi-Fi drivers so it can wirelessly work with this Wi-Fi card you've got in here, because right now, if you wouldn't be able to get internet on this unless you plugged in an Ethernet port, because there's no Wi-Fi drivers. You install a Wi-Fi driver for that Wi-Fi card, and then boom, you've got wireless internet on it. Do you have anything to say to the Arch Linux community?
I think it's a damn good idea. You just need somebody who's knowledgeable about computers to set it up for you, then perfect.
Okay, see you next time.
See you next time.